Matthew chapter number 5. If you have not done so already, do please take a moment to silence your cell phone. Matthew chapter number 5. I was thinking as I was chewing up the bread. That's the driest stuff I've ever put in my mouth. But I had a thought, you know, that unleavened bread, leaven in the Bible is a type of sin. So the unleavened bread, which represents the body of the Lord Jesus Christ, he was pure. His body was pure. He never sinned. But a thought occurred to me while I was thinking about how dry that was, that bread representing the body of Christ. I was thinking how dry he was as he hung on that cross.
Oh, yeah.
You remember what he said?
Yeah.
I thirst. Hours and hours of brutality had been inflicted upon our Lord. He had sweat profusely. The fluids of his body, his blood, had just been pouring out of him. It was an effusion of blood, an unrestrained outpouring of blood. And he, as he hung on the cross, one of the last things he said was, "I thirst." He was dry. And just a thought that occurred to me while I was, because that was some pretty dry bread, wouldn't you say? Amen. All right, we're in Matthew chapter 5, and for several weeks now we've been on a journey through that portion of the scriptures known as both the Beatitudes and or the Sermon on the Mount. We pick up today in verse number 13, where he says, "Ye are the salt of the earth."
Amen.
"But if the salt have lost his savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is henceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out and be trodden under foot of men. Ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all that are in the house. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven." I've entitled the message today, "Filling the Bill." Filling the Bill. And I'll explain why I chose that title in just a moment. Let's go to the Lord together in prayer, and I'd ask you to pray for your preacher. Pray for yourself that God would give you understanding. Pray for the person sitting next to you, that God would meet whatever need he might have or she might have in her heart today. Father, we love you so much. And Lord, today we were reminded once again of the awful price you paid to give us life. Lord, of the horror and the brutality that you experienced as you took our sins upon your body. They were judged on the cross of Calvary. Thank you for loving us so much, Lord. I'm reminded where he said, "Behold, what manner of love the Father hath bestowed upon us that we should be called the sons of God." We love you today. We pray that you will give us understanding as we look at these few verses. Lord, that it will make a difference in our lives, and we will maybe have a greater appreciation for the responsibility that we bear as men and women who name the name of Christ. Please enable your servant. We'll be grateful. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. Again, I've entitled the message, "Filling the Bill." The word "bill" is defined as a written or printed public notice, a written or printed statement, such as a bill of rights or a bill of sale, or on and on we could go. But here in our text, God has given us a bill, if you will, a written statement and a public notice that declares that you who have trusted Christ as your Savior are in fact the salt of the earth and the light of the world. That, my brothers and sisters, is a pretty heavy billing. He did not say that we are an alternate source of salt and light. No, he uses the definite article the, T-H-E, and he says you are the salt of the earth and you are the light of the world. That's how God has designated you and I. That's how God has built those of us who have been born again. I ask you this morning this simple question: are you filling the bill? Are you being the salt and the light that God has called us to be? The dictionary defines the term fill the bill as, quote, to satisfy the requirements of a written or printed statement. To satisfy the requirements of a written or printed statement. And so I ask you again, are you being the salt that God has called you to be in the little corner of the earth where he has entrusted you? And are you being the light that God has called you to be in those dark enclaves of the earth in which God has strategically placed you? Quite simply, are you filling that bill? In order to answer that question properly, there are a few things that I believe we need to understand, remembering that to fill the bill is defined as to satisfy the requirements. And so let's begin with number one, the fact that the requirement involves being more so than it does doing. The requirement involves being more so than it does doing. Stay with me now, because if you miss this, you miss the whole point of the message. The requirement involves being more so than it does doing. Notice again, verse 13, Jesus said, ye are the salt of the earth. And in verse 14, ye are the light of the world. Now, you older folks had grammar. We all had grammar in school, right?
Yeah.
Y'all remember what the state of being verbs were? Is, am, are, was, were. Be, being, been, you remember them? Eight state of being verbs. Ye are the state of being. The point is that it doesn't matter at all what you happen to be doing, whether it's building a building or painting a wall or washing dishes or scrubbing a floor or even hitting a golf ball. You're supposed to be salt and light while you're doing whatever it is you do in life.
Amen.
I'm supposed to be salt and light. Light. I know some Christians, and you probably do too, people who name the name of Christ that think it's okay to use the same filthy language on the job or wherever they are as their unsaved counterparts do. When we talk and act just like the world does, then we cease to be the salt and the light. The requirement, again, involves being something more than it does doing something. Let me illustrate it with the verse from Acts chapter 1. Jesus said to his disciples, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, Samaria, and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. Notice again, he said, ye shall be witnesses unto me. And again, state of being verb. He did not say, ye shall do witnessing for me. And don't get me wrong, I'm for doing witnessing. There's probably nobody that's knocked on more doors in Zephyr Hills over the last 35 years than I have. So I've done a lot of witnessing, but it's not what he's talking about here. He's talking about what you are, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. It's one thing to go out and knock on doors and do witnessing. It's quite another to be a witness. You and I are to be salt and light no matter what we happen to be doing at any given time of any given day. Biblical Christianity is an all-pervasive lifestyle, and it's based solely on biblical principles of morality and purity and godliness. True Christianity is something that we are, not something that we do once a week on Sunday morning. The Bible teaches us that God is constantly at work, seeking to transform you and I into the very image of his Son, Jesus Christ. It is a way of life. Ye are the salt of the earth. Ye are the light of the world. Let me ask you a question. Are you filling the bill? May I say to you that salt serves a number of very important functions. When I was a young boy, I grew up in a state that is characterized by our production of pork. So we had a lot of hogs when I was a boy growing up. And back in the early 60s, late 50s, early 60s, our family, I come from a large family. My mother was the baby of seven girls. And a lot of our relatives had hogs. And we would set aside a day to have what we called Hog Killing Day. And it was an entire day, a very grueling process of killing those hogs. Anybody ever been involved in that?
Amen.
Well, a lot of you. Well, praise God. So it was a job. I mean, it was all day job that involved making the sausage and processing all of that meat, 300 or 400 pound hogs, and hams were hung in the smokehouse, chitlins were fried. Anybody know what chitlins are?
Yeah.
I'll not get into that. But another thing that we would do on Hog Killing Day was a lot of that meat would be packed in salt in 5 gallon tin cans. And again, salt preserves. You and I who know the Lord, the word preserve, by the way, is defined as to keep from spoilage, to keep from harm. It means to protect. And that meat inside that salt, packed in that tin, that salt would preserve that meat for on and on and on and on and on. And may I say to you that you and I who know the Lord, who are the salt of the earth, are to be spiritual life preservers to those around us who are perishing without Christ in this world. They may make fun of you and I, they may persecute us, but when trouble comes knocking on their door, you will be the very first person they'll begin to look for. You'll be the first person they'll come looking for. Why? Because they know that you know God. And they know that you walk with God and talk with God and that you have power with God. And when trouble comes, as it always does, they're not going to be hunting up their beer buddies or their dope buddies or their carousing buddies. They're going to come looking for somebody who is salt and light.
Amen.
Somebody who knows God, because they know that you know God. If you walk with God, then you will be salt and you will be light in this dark and dreary world. And my gosh, is this world ever getting dark?
Amen.
By the minute. But if you talk like they talk, act like they act, then they won't be looking to you for any help, because you're no different than they are. They know whether or not it's real, or if Christianity is just something you do once a week on Sunday morning. And so salt preserves and salt protects It keeps from spoilage. Not only does salt preserve, but secondly, salt is a healer. It detoxifies. And there are a lot of people, toxic people in this world,
yes,
that need some detoxification, amen?
Yes.
You ever heard of Epsom salt?
Yes.
If you were to Google that Epsom salt, you would find immediately that it reads 10 healthy benefits derived from using Epsom salt. People with canker sores often gargle with salt water. You ever done that?
Oh, yeah.
People with open wounds will soak in salt water. People with swollen muscles and sprains will soak in warm salt water. Salt is a healer. I remember when we was planting palm trees at my other church, they were like 35 or 40 really nice queen palm trees. And this lady that did all that for us, she would sprinkle salt around the base of those palm trees, and somehow or another it helped them trees to grow. And God says that you and I that know Him are the salt of the earth. Let me ask you again, are you filling the bill? The requirement involves being more so than doing. And having said that, let me be clear that if you are being, you will also be doing.
Yes.
James said that faith without works is dead.
Yes.
Being alone. Some people, on the other hand, are trying to do without being.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean by that?
Yes.
They're trying to do spiritual things, but they've not been born again. And it's really impossible to do that. For the last few weeks, I don't know how many times I've had the Jehovah's Witnesses, and I'm not knocking them, but they don't know God, but they're trying to tell. It's amazing, they'll come to a church and knock on the pastor's door to try to convert the pastor to become a Jehovah's Witness. The Mormons do the same thing. They're trying to be by doing. You can't be by doing, amen. You have to be born again, and then you can do. But so, the problem is they have religion without a relationship. The second requirement for filling the bill is, number two, you must maintain your saltability. That's in verse 13 of our text. He said, you're the salt of the earth. But if the salt has lost his savor, wherewith shall it be salted? It is henceforth good for nothing but to be cast out and to be trodden under foot of men. You must maintain your saltability, your savor. So not only does salt preserve and heal, but salt also seasons. The word season is defined as to add zest and enjoyment to. It means to make savory that which is otherwise bland and tasteless. No wonder God said, you're the salt of the earth. To add zest and enjoyment, to make savory that which is otherwise bland and tasteless. Thank God for salt.
Amen.
I had a heart attack. They said, you can't have no more salt. Yeah. They said, get you some Mrs. Dash.
Uh-huh.
So I did. You ever tried Mrs. Dash? How about, I can't believe it's not salt.
Yeah.
I had no trouble believing it. Mrs. Dash, what a worthless investment that was. Amen. Thank God for salt. Can you imagine having to eat without? I mean, I know some of you do. God bless you. But how bland would a baked potato be without salt?
Yeah.
Or anything. Thank God for seasoning. Listen, folks. People who don't know Jesus Christ live lives that are bland and tasteless. They try to spice up their lives with alcohol or drugs or materialism or parties or travels, but it just don't work. They need the salt of the earth. Henry David Thoreau, you've heard me say this many times, the noted poet, wrote that most men live lives of quiet desperation. Why? Because they don't have the salt of the earth. Most men, and it's pitiful, most men live lives of quiet inner desperation. They don't speak it aloud. They just go through the drudgery of day after day after day, bland and tasteless. And so, because their lives are that way, they look to those of us who are the salt of the earth. They need desperately for some godly, non-judgmental, non-threatening, born-again believer to begin to sprinkle the salt of the Word of God, amen, the gospel of Jesus Christ on their soul. But the problem is, far too many Christians have lost their savor. They've lost their saltability. They've lost their ability to season the lives of others. They've become insipid themselves. The word insipid is defined as dull, tasteless, without any particular flavor. Their lives mirror those of the world. Their heart is as cold as ice. They rarely, if ever, warm by the fire of the Word of God and prayer. They're just simply too busy for that, too enamored with the glitz and the glitter of the world for that. That's what happened to Lot. Remember Abraham's nephew, Lot? Mm-hmm. The Bible says that he got very comfortable in Sodom, and Lot was a saved person. We know that from the book of 1 Peter, I believe it is. But Lot fell in love with the world in Sodom. And when Lot tried to warn his family, you remember God sent the angels to Sodom to warn Lot that he was about to destroy the city, Sodom and Gomorrah. The Bible says that Lot went to his sons-in-law, and when he tried to warn them of the imminent doom upon Sodom and Gomorrah, the Bible says that he said to them, "Up, get you out of this place, for the Lord will destroy this city." Listen to this. But he seemed as one that mocked unto his sons-in-law. What does that mean? It means that Lot had become so much like the world that his sons-in-law said, "What are you talking about, old man? You don't know what you're talking about." He had no power, he had no authority, because as the salt of the earth, he had lost his savor. He had no influence on them boys, and they perished in the fires and brimstone that destroyed Sodom. He had lost his savor. Then lastly this morning, in order to feel the bill, you must, number three, come out of the closet, so to speak. That's a pretty common term these days, but I'm not talking about it in that way. We've got far too many Christians who are secret agents for the Lord. Clandestine Christians, covert Christians. They're undercover. They're members of the CIA, which means Christians Inaccessible. They're operating incognito. How do you like all these big words? Which means under a concealed identity. Jesus said in verse 16, "Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven." First of all, let me say that light dispels darkness. That's pretty simple truth, that you walk into a dark building, you flip on a light switch, and instantly darkness flees. Well, there's a lot of people who are walking in spiritual darkness. They're groping, trying to ever try to find your way it's terrifying, isn't it?
Yep.
Try to find your way in a dark room, groping. The word groping means to feel one's way in the dark. And people are trying to find their way in this dark and dreary world. And they just need somebody who is light to dispel that darkness and to show them the way clearly. Someone who knows the life-changing Word of God. David said in Psalm 119, "Thy word is a what? A lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." It is the Word of God in you that causes you to glow, to shine. And the more you have of God in you, the more you have of the Word of God in you, the Spirit of God in you, the more you will glow. And people will notice it. They'll see that light. When you post some spiritual truth on Facebook, as many of you do, I see it. Neve, I see your posts. She's all the time posting scripture on Facebook. You know what you're doing? You're being light. You're being light to everybody that reads that post. And a lot of you do that. God bless you for doing that. You are being the light of the earth. God says, you are the light of the world. Not a light. You are the very life of God. You're it. You may be the only light someone will ever see.
Amen.
I remember when I was 16 years old, I was not brought up in a Christian home. We never went to church. We never opened a Bible in my home. My parents were decent parents, but they were not Christians at that time. And at 16, I got a job with the auto parts place. And there was a young man there, probably about my age. I was 16, and back in the back of the building where the paint, where he mixed the automobile paint, there was somebody had brought a magazine, one of those like Playboy or something like that. And I remember picking that up, and Donnie Avery was over there mixing some paint close by. And I just held it up and said, "Look at that, Donnie." He said, "Oh no, I can't look at that." And I said, "Why?" He said, "Because I'm a Christian." And at 16, the first light I ever saw in my life was that boy. And was he ever more a bright light?
Thank you, Lord.
The more I was around him, the more I got to know him. He sang you would have loved him, Paul. He sang in a gospel quartet called The Boys from Bethlehem. He went to Bethlehem Baptist Church. But within two or three years of that encounter, I got saved myself. But I never forgot the light that he was. You may be the only light somebody will ever see. In closing this morning, I ask you again, my dear brothers and sisters, are you filling the bill? Jesus said, you are it. You are the light of the world, and you are the salt of the earth. Are you filling that bill? Are you being salt and light? If not, then why not? If not, why not purpose in your heart this morning that you're going to be, it's never too late, to change for the better, amen? That is till we draw our last breath. It's never too late to get right with God. All right, let's stand together. Brother Paul's going to come lead us in a hymn of invitation.
Turn in your sunshine book to page number 45. Page 45, trust and obey. when we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word. What a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still.
Tonight, 6 o'clock, we continue our study in the book of 1 Corinthians. And Brother Harold, I ask you if you will please to dismiss us.
Our dear, gracious, merciful God, again, we just rejoice and we thank you.